see that? Because I will not be doing it again.
This is a jar of dirt.
Yes.
Is the jar of dirt going to help?
If you don't want it, give it back.
Huh.
Then it helps.
We are not chatting right now. You have three hostages.
You mean Pam and the two Bobs? They're not hostages. I prefer to call them collateral friendships. I gave them each $500 out of my own pocket.
Thanks again, Doug.
You the man, Doug.
Actually, I'd rather still not be a hostage.
Pam hasn't come around on me yet.
Do you enjoy hurting people?
Do you enjoy killing?
I'll kill you.
What, like you did your mother?
Take her name out of your mouth. You don't deserve to mourn.
Now, an important thing to remember about self-defense is anything and everything can be used as a weapon. So I want you right now to scan the environment and find something that you can hurt me with. Excellent. Now, how would you attack me with this?
Yeah, next lesson.
You won't die, but you'll wish you could.
Well... In that case, look, I'm not going to bother. I'll just turn around.
At the end of my days when I'm through, no word that I've written will ring quite as true as burn. Burn, butcher, burn. Burn, butcher, burn.
Hi there! Good afternoon! Did you find everything okay? Yep, just buying some dice. Oh, nice! Are you sure you only want the one set? Oh, totally. It's got all the sets and dice I'll ever need for D&D. Okay. See you soon. What? What?
What your D&D class of choice says about you.
People who play barbarians are simultaneously the chillest people to hang out with and the most stressful. Like, they'll spend all day with you just getting drunk and watching reruns of Parks and Rec, and you'll have a great time. But you make one little joke about wanting to break into Area 51, and they're in the car, they're ready, and they're like, I want to steal me an alien. People who play wizards are too smart for their own good. They've also seen every episode of Doctor Who, they have a favorite doctor, and they're ready to give you their dissertation about why their favorite doctor is the best doctor. People who play monks are like the broiest friend in their normal friend group, but they're like the artistic sensitive one in their bro friend group. People who play bards are funny as hell, but they're fuckboys. And if you're watching this right now and you're like, but I'm not a fuckboy and I play a bard, it's because something's keeping you from being a fuckboy, but you want to be a fuckboy.
There's a saying, a jack of all trades is a master of none. And it breaks my heart when people, when they use it and they don't understand that the original saying is actually longer than that. Are you familiar?
No.
A jack of all trades is a master of none, but still always better than a master of one is actually the complete quote.
I'm going to read you your rights. If you have any questions, you tell me, okay?
Can I just be shot?
Are you pondering what I'm pondering?
Whew. Oh, I'd say the odds of that are terribly slim, Brain.
True.
I mean, really, when have I ever been pondering what you've been pondering?
To my knowledge, never.
Exactly. So, what are the chances that this time I'm pondering what you're pondering?
Next to nil.
Well, that's exactly what I'm thinking, too.
Therefore, you are pondering what I'm pondering.
Put. I guess I am.
How to fight gods in D&D, not in real life. Defeating an ancient god like Tiamat can feel like the ultimate challenge in D&D, so I've got two tips here. Tip number one is don't do it. I know there are stat blocks for Tiamat and for other gods, but I feel like at any level, a player shouldn't be able to take down a being of this scale. Getting dropped to zero HP by a gang of adventurers kind of undermines the whole concept of being a god. But tip number two is if you're going to do it, redefine what winning looks like for your players. For example, winning could mean holding off the god just long enough so that the players could perform a ritual to expel it from the material plane. Or winning could mean defeating the avatar of the god, not the god itself. Perhaps this being has entered our world by possessing a mortal creature, and in that form the players could defeat it. The important thing is to have that final climactic battle without undermining the status and power level of a godlike being. That's just my opinion. If you can find a better way to make it work, more power to you.
I persuade the guards to leave their post is just as good.
I love the heart behind this video and I love the creator too, but I have to respectfully disagree. Dungeons & Dragons is a role-playing game. Role-playing is part of the course. After all, we don't expect DMs to tell you, the bad guy convinces you not to attack him now. Of course, you would expect the DM to role-play that in the same way. If you go to a soccer game, someone doesn't get to just choose not to actually attempt a kick. They can't just say, and I make that kick. You would say, well, no, you have to make that kick yourself. As a DM, I think it falls on the DM to take each player into consideration and to gently pull that roleplay out of a character. I have a character like that myself in one of my games, and when I want them to roleplay, I say, so what's the gist of what you're trying to communicate here? And I lower the DC for them accordingly. And I think that's the best way to do it. That's just my advice. But to say you don't have to roleplay in Dungeons & Dragons, I think that's too broad a brush. Just my thoughts. I wish you the best of luck.
My mistake in that first campaign was building a plot that basically depended on the players finishing one piece of content before they could move on to the next piece of content. It was a linear path, and when inevitably the players struck off that path, I was left with nothing prepared. Now I plan my campaigns not as a linear story, but as a collection of mini-stories, which can all be initiated at pretty much any time with a few minor adjustments. In the campaign I'm currently running, the players have become a little sidetracked. They've spent quite a long time trying to help a town with its local economic problems, trying to resurrect a local timber industry. That's fine, but I can tell they're not going to go and deal with the bandit lord I have waiting for them up north, at least not for the time being. But that's fine, because I have plenty of other story arcs ready to go. I'm going to initiate a demon invasion, and that's going to be the story arc that will see them through probably the next 10 sessions. It could have happened anywhere, but it's going to happen here.
The legend, or the story, goes a little something like this. A long time ago, the devil used to sell his items and artifacts to potential buyers and demons. He would sell them items such as the scent of lust, collars of greed, blades that would inflict wounds of anger, and other items and weapons that would shoot pride deep into the heart of unsuspecting souls. With these weapons and more, demons were able to spread darkness across the world that much better. One day, a potential buyer arrived, another demon, and as he perused the devil's wares, he saw in the back corner something that caught his eye. On a pedestal, very plain looking, sat two items, unmarked. An old wooden mallet and a very boring looking wooden spike. He inquired of these, and the devil quickly said, "Those are not for sale." The demon, even more curious now, asked, "Why? What are they? Explain." The devil said, "They are discouragement and doubt. Together, they become hopelessness. They are my most powerful weapons. When none of my other items work, I employ the work of these two, and they get the job done every time." "How so?" said the demon, wanting to know very much more. The devil sighed and leaned in and said, "Nothing paralyzes a soul more than discouragement and doubt. While my other items may cause a soul to act out, such as anger or lust, hopelessness, discouragement, doubt, cause a soul to do nothing. which is much more deadly. They are no respecter of persons. They drain their victim of courage and faith, causing their visions and dreams to be blurred and blotted out by anxiety and fears. And when a soul has fully succumbed to hopelessness, they become empty shells, sacks, with only enough energy to feel sorry for themselves. So, adventurous soul, if even the weapons of pride, anger, greed, or lust have no effect on you, beware the dull spike of discouragement and doubt. Hold on to what encourages and inspires your hearts, and those that care about you, let them love on you, and love them enough to let them know when you need them. Be safe out there.